Welcome back to our chapel chat. This is for Thursday, July 23rd. Christian?
Okay, so today's gospel comes from Matthew chapter 13, verse 10 through 17. The disciples approached Jesus and said, "Why do you speak to the crowd in parables?" He said to them in reply, "Because knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven has been granted to you, but to them it has not been granted. To anyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. From anyone who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because they look, but do not see, and hear, but do not listen or understand. Isaiah's prophecy is fulfilled in them, which says, 'You shall indeed hear, but not understand. You shall indeed look, but never see. Gross is the heart of this people. They will hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and be converted and I heal them. But blessed are your eyes because they see and your ears because they hear. Amen, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. It's a very interesting question. Why do you speak to the crowd in parables? I mean, Jesus, a lot of his preaching was in parables. Mm-hmm. And what Jesus says is the reason why some people believe in the gospel and other people don't. Mm. It strikes to the heart of why some people believe and some people don't. And I think this is very instructive for us today, in which we live in a culture that is turning away from God, turning away from the gospel, and is believing something else. He ultimately says, the reason why I speak in parable is because some people are able to perceive the kingdom of God in it, and some people aren't. Parables have a very interesting concealment of the truth, mm-hmm. and also a revealing of the truth. The parables both conceal and reveal. So for those people whose hearts are open, right? He's quoting Isaiah here about those whose hearts are closed, right? Their hearts, he says, gross is the heart of this people. They don't open their ears, they don't open their eyes, right? They're blind to the truth. But for those who do have their hearts open, mm-hmm. their eyes are able to see. That's why he commends them. Blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. And so he teaches in parables to kind of basically expose unbelief for what it is, but also to draw people in to that belief. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that really struck me too when I was in seminary formation was I always wondered why God wouldn't just constantly be performing miracles that would force people to believe in him. Right? And then vice versa, why some people didn't believe in the miracles that Jesus did. Like, I didn't understand mm-hmm. that. God, if you're real, just kind of basically force people to believe in you. Like, basically just make it so unquestionable that everyone's going to believe in you. Yeah. The problem is that wouldn't be a free act of faith, right? It would be forcing people to believe, and he doesn't want that. Yeah. So parables have a way of drawing people that are open in, like it's a revelation of the nature of God. But if your heart is not open, you're not able to access the mysteries of the kingdom in parables. In fact, you don't really think much of them. And Jesus himself is like a parable. He himself both reveals and conceals. Mm-hmm. And so if your heart is not open to God, you will reject Jesus. And this is actually one of the brilliant parts about the gospel. Is that it's for those who are open and they'll hear the gospel clearly, they will respond with faith if it's preached yeah. right and clearly.
Right.
But if you're not, then you're just going to say, "Well, I don't need this," right?
Yeah.
So it's a fascinating understanding, and I'm sorry for getting into all that, but it's just yeah. like this idea of the parabolic nature of revelation is so powerful.
Right. Yeah. I remember this past year in seminary. I believe the professor said, "Why does Jesus speak in parables?" I could be wrong, but I think he said, you know, to divide those from who understand and those who don't, or those who accept the teaching of God and those who don't. And I always found that, let's see, a little, I always struggled with that a little bit too. You know, like why does Jesus do this? Doesn't he want everybody to follow him, to grow more in love mm-hmm. with him? So mm-hmm. why would he teach in parables like this? And so, you know, after reading this gospel, you know, you see the disciples. Jesus says, because knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven has been granted to you, but to them it has not been granted. And so I tried, praying about that, like, what does that exactly mean? Why are only some people this is granted to? And I think you mentioned it, there has to be an openness, a willingness to receive the truth a little bit. Mm-hmm. If you're just constantly you relying on yourself, or you believe you have everything, figured out already, and you're not really open to what others have to say, or even Christ himself, then you aren't going to hear. You know, like Isaiah said, you have eyes, but you can't see, ears can't hear. I think that's what he's trying to say here. You know, if you have this prideful mentality that you have everything figured out, you know what your life is going to be, I think this is what Jesus is saying here.
That's exactly right. And I think there are people who don't allow God to speak to them. Mm-hmm. They don't want God to speak to them. And that's why they don't allow it, right? So I have a resistance to God, because if God is God, that means I'm not. That means I have to somehow surrender my will, surrender my life in one way or another. And that resistance kind of gives produces a kind of a blindness in which we can't see what Jesus is saying. So mm-hmm. if Jesus were here, a lot of people are like, oh, if Jesus was here, if I just saw a miracle, if I just saw this, if Jesus was here and he spoke to me, I would believe. It's like, actually, you probably wouldn't. Because he says over and over again, if they don't believe you, they're not going to, like, they reject you, they reject me, right? Those, they don't accept you, they don't accept me. And the reason is that the nature of the heart, the condition of the heart, has everything to do with whether or not we accept the teaching of Jesus. The only other thing that I would say, which is critically important for us as a church, and I think in many ways challenges us the most, is, are we preaching the gospel clearly? Are we preaching Jesus and his words clearly? Mm-hmm. Because if we're not, the unbelief of some people is our fault, not God, not the individual's fault. And I actually mm-hmm. believe that's the case. I believe that there are a lot of people who have never heard a compelling case for the gospel. They've only they've come across counterfeit versions of the gospel, counterfeit versions of Christianity, you know, versions that had all sorts of dysfunctions and difficulty and all this other stuff, where they really couldn't hear the gospel, or they never really heard the authentic gospel of grace, of salvation in Jesus. And so they reject it. Well, they're rejecting a counterfeit. They haven't really rejected Jesus. Mm-hmm. And God knows that. But the fact is that a lot of times, and this is the case in my own life, I just don't want to convert. I don't want to change my heart in a particular area. I don't want to hear God speak to me, because that means I'll have to change, and change involves fear. And so I'd rather choose my fear than choose faith, right? But what's so critical here is that this is the reason why there is that division. And it's because it's the nature of the heart. Parables, if we believe, they reveal truth. Think about the parable of the seed and the sower, which we had a couple weeks ago in the gospel, right? This parable explains the nature of the kingdom in such a way that helps us understand who God is and who we are, and helps us enter into that mystery. But for people who don't have their hearts open, they're like, this doesn't mean anything to me. And if anything, it kind of just exposes their unbelief, right? So it's a fascinating thing that Jesus does. And it's the same with scripture. It's the same with just preaching in general. If people's hearts are open, they're going to respond. If their hearts aren't open, it's going to seem like this is meaningless to me.
I think you're onto something, because what came to my mind was when you're talking about preaching of the gospel, especially, you know, referring to like bishops and priests and deacons, or anybody evangelizing, I don't think it's good for, especially the church, if it's sort of like watered down, everyone, except I don't know what exactly I'm saying, but if you're like watering down the gospel, it's sort of not presenting the truth. Mm-hmm. Sort of what was the opposite of Christ.
That's right.
Christ, I mean, proclaimed the gospel with boldness. He and when he spoke, people actually left him, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I think we're going to, especially the church, we're going to have to reorient how we're going to proclaim the gospel with like boldness and courage, with charity and, you know, faith in God. And yeah, maybe some people, maybe that will strike something in people's heart where they're going to have to choose. Is it, do I want to put God above myself and humble myself to listen to his will, or do I want to continue living my life for my own?
That's right. And I think one of the greatest tragedies in life in general is corruption within the body of Christ, within those who are preaching the gospel. I mean, there are, I mean, if the preachers of the gospel have their hearts and their eyes and their ears closed, they're not able to represent Jesus and preach him effectively, right? And so this is why, I mean, being a priest and being a seminarian, we're called to a great height, a level of sanctity, so that we can preach with great clarity and with great conviction the truth of who Jesus is. Otherwise, people have no chance, in one sense. And this doesn't rely totally on priests, but if priests themselves, if bishops and deacons and are just watering it down, we're not really presenting Jesus. We're not giving people an opportunity to reject Jesus nor to accept him. Mm-hmm. We're giving a caricature of Jesus that people accept and reject. Well, that's not going to help anybody.
Right.
Right. Even people like who are practicing their faith, but are practicing their faith only because they have accepted a caricature of Jesus, that's not helping them, because the fullness of what God offers in the life of the Holy Spirit, in the life of the moral life, can only happen when Jesus himself is presented, not some sort of caricature based on some sort of political projection onto him, or whatever you want to call it, you know. God very, very much wants to be preached truthfully. Mm-hmm. And I just think the parabolic nature of Revelation, right? Some people get it and some people don't. There's a lot of reasons for that, but one of them is some people have their hearts open and some people don't. It's a fascinating thing to think about as we preach the gospel.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you said that, it just reminded me, when we're watering down the gospel, we're giving people just an image of Jesus. But Jesus is just, he's alive, he's a person, he's mm-hmm. the Son of God, and he just wants you to know you're loved, and he wants a relationship with you. Mm-hmm. And when you present it in that way, you know, it does. I think people are going to have to make a decision in their life, mm-hmm. whether to reject them or to accept them.
That's right. Yeah. And for a lot of people, it's very scary to have to have God be God and them not, right? Mm-hmm. It's very scary. Right. And that's why Jesus is always saying to us, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Yeah. Essentially saying, I've come not to take anything good from you, but I've come to take everything from you that is preventing you from entering into the very goodness that you were made for. And I think that's, if our culture can hear that, that God has not come to stealing anything from us. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. God has come to give us life and life to the abundance. That's what he wants. Mm-hmm. But if we do not have our hearts open, we will reject Jesus and therefore reject his life. Mm. That's why we need to preach the gospel clearly. All right?
Amen.
All right. So let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus, we thank you. And we praise you for revealing yourself to us. We thank you, Lord, that that we who have faith have eyes to see and ears to hear. Not because of our own doing, but because of the mystery of your grace. You've given us faith. But we ask that you open the eyes and ears of all those who do not believe and send someone into their lives to preach the gospel, to share with them what you have done by your suffering and death on the cross and the power of your resurrection. Lord, help all the people that we love to open their eyes to the reality of your truth, so that accepting you and having a relationship with you, we may all live with you forever. And we ask all of this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.